definition. Okay, ma'am, we are live now and
Yes,
recording.
sir.
Recording started from my side, so
Now,
you can start at 9:20. Okay, ma'am.
yes, sir. Yes.
Okay.
इजून जाता ना दिसतो इथे फार लाईट आहे सगळं Good morning. This is Kulkarni Madhavi from RCF Junior College, Alibag. In our last lecture, we have studied about few phylum of non-chordata. We have studied the characteristic of Porifera, Cnidaria, Deinophora, Platyhelminthes, and Aschelminthes. The remaining phylum of non-chordate we are going to study today. The remaining phylum The first phylum we are going to study is phylum Annelida. The phylum Annelida first I will show you some animals of annelids. Here there are three animals I have shown from the phylum Annelida. The first is a Nereis, second is a Hirudo. The Hirudo is also called as leech, commonly called as leech. Third is a Ferretima, which we commonly call earthworm. Now we are going to study the characteristic of phylum Annelida. The characteristic, these animals are commonly called as ringworms because you will see on their body many ring-like structures are there, and these ring-like structures, they are not present only on the outer surface, but this segmentation, what we call, they are present within their body also. That is why these animals are also called as segmented worms. These annelids, they show bilateral symmetrical and they are metamorphically segmented animals. They show locomotion with the help of muscles, and these muscles, longitudinal and circular muscles, are present in their skin, and because of which contraction and relaxation, actually the locomotion is possible. But in addition to muscles, they have got some locomotory organs also. For example, the setae are present in earthworm, the parapodia are present in Nereis, and the leech, it moves with the help of suckers. So these are the locomotory organs. Now in this slide, I have shown the metamerization in earthworm. What I told, they are commonly called as ringworms because these annuli or ring-like structures, they are present on the external part of their body. In addition to that, this part is open, and inside it also we can see the arrangement of various organs and system. This arrangement of organ and system is somewhat similar in every segment. For example, in the center, some part of the digestive system is present. Suppose in segment number 6, in segment number 20 also, you will get part of the digestive system. Just above it, the part of circulatory system or some part of the excretory system or nephridia. Such similar arrangement is seen in all the segments, and that is the meaning of true metamerization, which is seen in this animal, earthworm, and it is a peculiarity not only of the earthworm, but it is present in all other annelids also. This slide is showing the setae in the earthworm. I told this animal, it moves with the help of skin muscles. These skin muscles, they undergo contraction and relaxation. But if you have seen the locomotion of earthworm, some part of the body, it fixes to the ground. And for that fixing, this chitinous hair-like structures, the setae here, few segments, they are showing the setae coming out of the body, and this is a sectional view, widely paired setae. This chitinous hair-like structure, they are useful in animal for the locomotion or for the anchoring, and the remaining body part is contracted, and with help of which the earthworm shows locomotion. In this Nereis, the parapodia or the paired structures are present in every segment. See, we are going to study the next phylum, Arthropoda, where also appendages are there. But the difference in the parapodia, that is of annelid, and appendages of Arthropoda, in Arthropoda, they are jointed. But in this animal, Nereis, the parapodia, they are just extension of each segment. No joints are there. So this, with help of this parapodia, the Nereis shows locomotion. Some other characteristic we will study of the phylum Annelida. Elementary canal is a complete one, that is from the first segment to the last segment. Digestive system is present. The respiration or the exchange of gases, that is absorption of oxygen and giving out carbon dioxide, is occurring in all the annelid with the help of spleen. The spleen is a respiratory organ in all annelids. And that is why we will see no exoskeleton or no other external structure present on the spleen. The spleen is always kept smooth, moist, to absorb the oxygen and to give out the carbon dioxide. The next point, they show closed circulatory system. This is a common thing with the higher animals. The blood is always flowing either through heart or through blood vessels, and that is why it is called as closed circulatory system. The excretion is with the help of nephridia. These nephridia, in case of earthworm, they are present throughout the various segments, and variety of nephridia are there. They are doing the function of excretion. Most of the animals are hermaphrodite. Hermaphrodite, once again, the male and female reproductive organs are present in one and same organism, and that is why they are called as hermaphrodite. One more thing I want to tell you here about the earthworm. Though a single earthworm is having male and female reproductive system, generally the cross-fertilization takes place, or the mating is also there in earthworm. Okay, these examples, common example, Nereis. This Nereis is found in free living, and it is a marine animal found burrowing in the seashore. The Ferrethema, or the common earthworm, which is found in the moist soil, it is also a burrowing animal, and it is called as friend of farmer because it is increasing fertility of soil. So it is a useful animal for the human being. Hirudinaria, or the leech, is an interesting annelid because it is a blood-sucking animal. It is also called as sanguivorous, as the it takes blood meal. It sucks the blood of human being. It sucks the blood of other vertebrates also. And the locomotion is also with the help of suckers. So all this was about the phylum Annelida. Now next phylum we are going to study is phylum Arthropoda. Now in Arthropoda, in this picture, I have shown the variety of animals, some beetle, here this is a millipede animal, this is a barankle, a sedentary marine animal, this animal is a centipede, jala marathit ghon kiwa gom asa mantar, this is a stick insect, this is a mud fly, it is collecting mud to build the nest. Then scorpions are there. This is a spider, housefly, butterfly, crab, then shrimps. And here, the dragonfly, jala baras lahan mulanna yacha attraction asta, jala chatur mantat, pakadacha maga astat mula. All these are the examples of phylum Arthropoda. Why I have included so many animals? Because it is the largest phylum of the kingdom Animalia. Maximum number of species are there, which are belonging to the phylum Arthropoda. Arthros means jointed and poda means appendages. These animals have jointed appendages. These appendages, it may be an antenna, it may be a leg. Every appendage is made up of few joints. Next, the body is bilaterally symmetrical. It is triploblasty, that is during embryonic development, endoderm, mesoderm, and ectoderm, all the three layers are there. It is showing true body cavity, and these animals are also metamerically segmented animals. They show a tube within tube body plan. The organ system level organization is there, means the various systems are well developed. The animals show exoskeleton, which is a tough and it is tightly attached to the body wall. And when the animal grows, this exoskeleton becomes too tight and it has to be removed in between. And this property is called as molting or ichthyosis. Body is generally divisible into head, thorax and abdomen, especially the insects, which is one class of the phylum Arthropoda. They show the body divisible into head, thorax and abdomen. Circulatory system is always of open type. You remember one classic example of Arthropoda as a cockroach. In cockroach, the blood is fluid, which is called as hemolymph. It is flowing through the body cavity and it is not enclosed either in the heart or blood vessels are absent. Hemocell is the body cavity and the blood is openly filled or flowing in this hemocell. That is why circulatory system is open type. There are a variety of respiratory organs in case of this phylum. Some are having gills, some book lungs, book gills, and trachea. Trachea are the tubular organs found in the cockroach. They are absorbing oxygen and they are giving out carbon dioxide. Excretion also, variety of different organs are there. Some are having green glands, Malpighian tubules, which are found in cockroach, coxal glands. They are absorbing waste material from the body and they are throwing it out of the body. Many arthropods, they show the presence of sense organs like antennae. Zuracha misha, tela, they are giving sense of touch and smell also. Annala sparshapan karun bakto to mishani ani vas sudha geta hai to. So, antennae is a sensory organ. They are showing either simple or compound eyes for the vision and some other receptors are also present. This is a more developed character in the phylum Arthropoda. These animals, they show sexual dimorphism. We can identify a male and female separately without any dissection externally also. The development is either direct, that is no larval stage, or it is indirect, that is the fertilized egg first develops some larva and then the adult develops slowly by metamorphosis. The next is very interesting characteristic. The phenomena is called as parthenogenesis. It is shown by honeybees and bugs. Parthenogenesis is a phenomena where the development of individual from the egg take place without fertilization. This is a very interesting phenomena. Parthenogenesis, in case of honeybees, the drones or the males, they hatch out from the eggs without fertilization. And the next property, polymorphism. Polymorphism, first I will show you the diagram. Here, these are the three types of honeybees which are found in the single beehive. Honeybee is a social insect and in a single beehive or honeycomb, what we call it as, there is a single queen bee. Then there are many thousands of worker bees will be there and few hundred drone bees will be there. So these are the three different forms of honeybees only. And they are found or they are living together. And this phenomena is called as polymorphism. Structurally, they are different. Their functions are different. And they are living together because it is a social insect. In addition to the honeybees, ants and termites. Ants manje vegvegra prakarcha mungya. Kahi lal mungya astat, kalya mungya astat. Ani termites manje valvi. All they are social insects and they also show this polymorphism. Next part is the economic importance of phylum Arthropoda. Apis, which is a genus name of honeybees, they are found or useful for the wax and honey. Honey and wax, both the things can be obtained from bee hive or honeybees. Silk is obtained, which is economically important or giving even foreign currency, from the silkworm. Here, silkworm is a larval stage and the adult stage is called as silk moth. Lac is produced from lac insect. Marathi madhe lac manje lakh. Parcel seal karayla je lal color cha vaparta substance to lakh manje lac. The interesting thing or one thing I want to tell you about the lac production, the India has the largest lac production all over the world. And the lac is an excretion of some lac insect. They are growing on particular plants, trees, and they produce this lac, which is useful for the human being. Then the next, lobsters, prawns, kolambi, crabs, chimbori, lobsters, which is shaman, all they are edible. All the fish lovers, you are knowing these names. Out of this, these lobsters are they are exported to the foreigners, and it is a good giving amount foreign currency to our country. So they are edible or important as a food material. Then next point, mosquitoes, they are acting as a vectors. I want to tell you the names, three names of the diseases: malaria, filaria, and dengue. These are the three diseases. Here, the pathogen is a different, but this pathogen is taken from a diseased person to the healthy person with the help of mosquito bite. So mosquito is responsible for spreading the diseases. Actually, here only mosquito is written, but please remember the cockroaches, house fly, they are also responsible for spreading some of the diseases, and here they are called as vectors or the factors spreading the diseases. While locusts are the pest organism. I have got a slide for you. Few months ago, there were news about the locust attack. In our country, the Rajasthan, Gujarat, even in Maharashtra, in Amravati district, in Nagpur district, and in Punjab, many places were there, they were attacked with the locust swarms. In a single attack, the lakhs, millions of these insects, they attack the vegetation, that is maybe a crop or maybe the higher trees, and they eat out the leaves. And they destroy the crop on a large scale. So this is a single locust. Actually, ha, ek naak todacha prakar hai, jala apan grasshopper manto, but this is a gigantic grasshopper and the name is locust. Marathi tela tod dhad mantat. Tod ha ek prakarcha rakshasi prakarcha grasshopper hai. This is a one more interesting animal from the phylum Arthropoda. It is called as king crab. It is an aquatic arthropod. And it is considered as a living fossil because many of the characters, they are to the ancient animal. And that is why it is considered as a living fossil. And it is mentioned as one of the economically important animals. Now, this is a picture from your textbook. Periplaneta. L is not printed here. This is a cockroach. It is a millipede. Archispirostreptus is a genus name of a millipede. Yala Marathi madhe vani kida asa mhantat. Karan, if you touch this animal, it coils like a coin. That's why it is called as paisa kida kiwa vani kida mhantat. This is a scorpion. The genus name is Potentota. This scorpion, in its tail, the last segment, it is having a sting and at the base of the sting, a poison gland is there. The scorpion can give a bite and it can inject this poisonous fluid with the help of this tail. So these are the arthropod animal, and this was about the phylum Arthropoda. Next phylum we are going to study is phylum Mollusca. Here there are some pictures of from the phylum Mollusca. First is a pila. It is having a shell which is a single coiled shell, helix, commonly called as a snail, having this coiled shell. This is a limax. It is also a type of snail which is called as actually slug without shell. It is an interesting animal without shell. Mytilus, it is having a shell made up of two equal sized or similar valves. Octopus, again an interesting mollusk which is not having any shell. Unio, which is commonly called as a bivalve. Jala apan shimpla manto, don equal parts ahet shell che. Chiton, actually this is an interesting mollusk. It is looking like an arthropoda, but it is not an arthropod, it is a mollusk. And Dentalium, this is one of the marine animal having a tusk-like shell. Hattiza daat jasa asto, tasa yacha shell ahe. That's why the name is Dentalium. Dentalium, the word related with the teeth. Now, this picture is from your textbook. A spicula, a type of bivalve. Chitoplura, a chiton. A pila, that is having a single coiled shell. So here the shell is made up of two equal parts. Here the shell is made up of joints. Here the shell is a single coiled one. Shankha, shimpla. This is a sepia, where the shell is present within the body wall or inside the body wall. Internal shell is present. And this is an octopus, the mollusk without any shell. Now we will study the characters of phylum Mollusca. The first, some of them, they are aquatic, like sepia, octopus, they are marine in nature. Some are terrestrial. For example, snail is a terrestrial, and many are found in the marshy places. The unio, a type of animal which is found in the rice, waterlogged rice field, and it eats out the soft roots of the rice crop. They are found in waterlogged soil. All these animals are soft-bodied animals. They show tube within tube body plan, and the many mollusks, they become asymmetrical with the help of torsion. This torsion is a peculiar phenomena in case of Mollusca. You try to imagine a shell, jala apan shankha manto, ya shankha madhe rahnyasathi ya gogalgayla aplya body cha ek coil tayar karava lagto, and because of that twisting, or that phenomena is called as a torsion. The body gets accommodated within the coiled shell. Now, the body is divisible into head, muscular foot, and a visceral mass. This point, I will show you one diagram. At that point, I will explain it again. Now, the body or the visceral mass is covered with some cover. That cover is called as mantle. And this mantle cover only secretes a hard calcareous shell surrounding this visceral mass, and in which this soft-bodied animals remains protected. This shell, it may be external, it may be internal, or it may be absent, as in case of octopus. The muscular foot is a locomotory organ with help of which तुम्ही गोगलगाय चालताना बघितली असेल तो जो एक असा पार्ट ओढत ओढत चालते, दॅट पार्ट इज अ मस्क्युलर फूट. अँड इन केस ऑफ स्नेल इट लिव्ज अ सिल्व्हरी ट्रेल बिहाइंड वेअर इट गोज. द डायजेस्टिव सिस्टीम इज व्हेरी वेल डेव्हलप, बट इट ऑल्सो शोज द टॉर्शन. नेक्स्ट पॉइंट, दिस ॲनिमल दे शो अ रॅड्युला विच इज मेडअप ऑफ सम ट्रान्सफर्स रोज ऑफ टीथ they are present, this organ is present in buccal cavity and it is used for rasping or it is used for scratching of the food material. Here, this is a schematic diagram of one mollusk. I want to show you some parts. This mantle, this blue colored covering is called as a mantle. This mantle covers the entire body mass. This body mass is called as a visceral mass. And from the mantle only secretes a shell which covers this. And the out of shell, this muscular foot, here it is shown a muscular foot, it comes out and with the help of foot, generally the locomotion is there. Here this is a mouth. And inside the mouth, the radula is shown here. This radula is magnified here. It is showing some rows of the teeth. And because of that teeth, the animal scratches out its food material or the scrappings of the food material can be taken out. Some other characters of the mollusk we are studying, they show the presence of gills, which are also called as tinidia. They are respiratory organs in aquatic forms. They show open circulatory system, but an additional point is here, they show the presence of respiratory pigment hemocyanin, which makes the blood to carry oxygen. So that is why it is called as respiratory pigment. They show organ of Bojanus or the kidneys. They are the organ for excretion. In addition to that, these animals, they also show the presence of eyes, tentacles, ospidia. Now, eyes for vision, tentacles for touch or smell, and ospidia. It is an additional thing in case of mollusk, and it is useful for testing the purity of water. So this is one more sensory organ in case of mollusca. Now I want to tell you the economic importance of the phylum mollusca. The first one is pearl oyster. They ek prakar cha bivalve hai kiwa ha ek prakar cha shimpla hai. Moti tayar hota te shimpla madhe tayar hota. So it gives a precious pearl. Actually the animal is not behind producing the precious pearls. What happens to this animal? It is a soft-bodied animal. By mistake, a sand grain enters inside the shell. It causes the irritation to the animal. To avoid that irritation, they secrete some secretion over that sand grain and it continues and it produces a precious pearl. Actually, त्याला मोती तयार करायचा नसतो तर तो इरिटेशन रिमूव्ह करायसाठी हा मोती तयार करतो. And you are knowing, even nowadays, artificial pearls are produced from this pearl oyster by introducing a sand grain inside their body artificially. And the production of pearl is a natural process like that of a natural pearl oyster. Many mollusks like Pila, they are edible also. Or eaten out also. The sepia is also eaten and many edible mollusks are there. The shells of mollusks, they are the rich source of calcium. When the animals die, their shells settle at the bottom and they are made up of calcium carbonate, many chemicals are also obtained and it is used as a calcium source also. One more thing here I want to tell, a hermit crab, it is an arthropod that enters an empty shell of a mollusk and it survives or it takes that shell as a protective house over their body. Okay, these shells, many of the shells have cultural values. Tumhala maiti asel ki barese shankh devamadhe poojesathi vaparle jatat. Not only that, in Bengalis, the bangles are produced out of the shell. It is useful for, or it is having a cultural value also. So that was about the phylum Mollusca. Here we are going to study our next phylum, Echinodermata. In this picture, there are four echinoderms shown. The first is Antedon. The spelling should be actually Antedon, which is commonly called as sea lily. The second is Ophiothrix, which is called as brittle star. The third is Asterias, which is called as a starfish, or it is also called as sea star. The fourth one is Cucumaria, which is also called as sea cucumber. It looks like a cucumber, so it is called as sea cucumber. The characters of Echinodermata, most of these animals are exclusively marine. They are found in seawater. They show gregarious or very huge size. They can grow and they are benthic, found in the deeper layer of the seawater. They are radially symmetrical and they show pentamerous symmetry. Their exoskeleton is made up of calcareous ossicles. In Mollusca, we have seen the animals show the shell, which is made up of calcium carbonate. But here, the smaller plates are there. They are also made up of calcium carbonate, and that forms the exoskeleton or protective layer to the animal. Now, one more peculiar characteristic of these echinoderms, they show the presence of spines. Echinos means spiny and derma means skin. As this animal, they show the large spines over the body, they are called as echinoderms. So it may be a starfish, it may be a brittle star, they are having spines on their body. Now the body has oral and aboral surface. Here I want to show you this diagram. In this starfish, the flattened body is there. And generally the five arms are there. And this flattened body, the surface which is facing towards the sky is aboral surface. And the surface which is facing towards the sand, here in the center, the mouth is there and that part is, or that side is called as oral side. Water vascular system is a peculiar system present in all echinoderms. It is made up of various tubules, and that water vascular system is useful for respiration, for locomotion, and also for food capturing. So they do not have a special respiratory organ. In case of starfish, the tube feet, which are filled with this water fluid, they are useful for locomotion and also for food capturing. Next points. They show presence of gills, or some of them they show papillae or the respiratory tree. They are the variety of respiratory organs useful for respiration. Fertilization is external because male and female are separate. The development is indirect. Some larval stages are there and they show high power of regeneration. That is a peculiar thing in this animal. Even one or two arms of the starfish are broken, new arms are produced because they have regeneration power. Last phylum of the phylum non-chordata is phylum Hemichordata. They are exclusively marine animals. They are burrowing animals. They burrow holes in the sand. The body is long, worm-like, and it is divisible into proboscis, collar, and trunk. I will show you the diagram. This animal is Balanoglossus animal. Here I will show you this anterior harder part is called as a proboscis. This is a collar, and this entire part is called as a trunk. Proboscis, collar, and trunk. These are the three body parts, Balanoglossus, a worm-like elongated marine animal. This is one more animal, Sacoglossus. Again here, this is a proboscis, this is a collar, and this is a trunk. Now we'll study the characteristic of phylum Hemichordata. They show the presence of gills in the pharyngeal region, and also gill slits are present. Presence of gill slit is a character which is similar to that of chordate. Please remember, this is a non-chordate animal, but also it is showing paired gills as well as gill slits. The animal is bisexual. It shows external fertilization and indirect development because it shows a larval form. The last point is an important point. This phylum is a connecting link between a non-chordate and a chordate. Because this presence of gill slits is a common thing to the chordate character, but as notochord is not there, it is belonging to the non-chordate. So this were about all the phylums of the non-chordate. Let us revise some of the part which we studied today. We have studied phylum Annelida. In Annelida, I have shown you the Nereis, leech, and earthworm. The most important character, they are commonly called as ringworms and they are segmented worms. Different locomotory organs are there, like CT, parapodia, or suckers. True metamerically segmented arrangement is an important characteristic of phylum Annelida. CT of earthworm, I have shown. These are the parapodia of Nereis. Then, one more important characteristic of the annelid, please remember, the skin is a respiratory organ. So, skin is without any exoskeleton in case of annelida. Then, they are hermaphrodite animals. Then, we studied about the phylum Arthropoda. The jointed appendages is a peculiar characteristic of phylum Arthropoda. They also show some metameric segmentation. And the body is generally divisible into head, thorax, and abdomen. That point you have to remember most. Open circulatory system, various respiratory organs, excretion also, various different malpighian tubules and different parts are there. They are having well-developed sense organs like antennae, eyes, and some receptors are there. Parthenogenesis, development without fertilization, and polymorphism, variety of animals in a single species. Different forms are there, that is a polymorphism. Then we studied the economic importance. So some are useful. Because they are giving silk or they are giving honey or wax or some are producing lac. These are the useful things obtained from the arthropods. Some are edible. Some they even give the foreign currency, while some are harmful arthropods like mosquito, housefly, cockroaches. They spread diseases. So here they are called as vectors. And the locust, jala tol manto apan, it causes large amount of economic damage to the crops or to the vegetation. Here I have shown this diagram of the locust. This was a interesting animal, king crab. As it is showing very primitive characteristic, it is called as a living fossil. These are the common arthropods, scorpion, cockroach, a millipede. Then we studied about the phylum Mollusca, a soft-bodied animals having generally showing the presence of shell around their body and the body divisible into head, foot, and visceral mass. The presence of mantle or the covering that is secreting their cover or the shell. Then they show the presence of radula, that is a grasping organ. They are having open circulatory system and with the pigment. Then organ of Bojanus, excretory organ, and Ospredia, that is useful for testing the purity of water. We'll stop here today. Thank you very much. I'm thankful for my co-host, Mrs. Sadhana Upadhyay Madam from the Kirti College, Mumbai. Thank you.
Thank you, Madhavi ma'am.
Thank you, sir.
Next lecture to be continued.
Yes, sir.
Hello, Abhinav sir. I'm Prashant sir.
Okay, good morning, sir. Prashant sir.
Very good morning, sir. Then shall I start, sir?
Definitely, sir.
Can I clearly audible and visible?
Yes, sir.
Thanks a lot, Abhinav sir. Yeah, thank you. Thank you, Madhavi Kulkarni ma'am. Thank you, Abhinav sir. Thank you, SIRT. Yes, I would like to start now. Good morning to one and all student of Maharashtra. I'm Professor Prashant Patil. Along with me, my colleague and co-host, Professor Madhuri Tita ma'am, from Deccan Education Society, Kirtiam Dungarse College, Dadar West, Mumbai. I hope you all doing well during pandemic situation of COVID-19. I hope you're taking all precautions and preventing measure for keeping good health. Welcome you all for the virtual classroom of Science Stream for the subject of physics. But before that, before starting today's lecture, I would like to tell thanks Government of Maharashtra, Education Department, SIRT team, SIRT technical team, and as well as I would like to tell thanks our Parental Institute, Deccan Education Society, our principal and higher authorities of Kirtiam Dungarse College, for giving an opportunity for deliver such nice kind of lectures. So once again, welcome you all in this online lectures. So we like to start today's lecture. Actually, this is the third lecture of mathematical method, which is chapter number 2 from physics paper 1. This is the third lecture. So before starting our lecture, I would like to share my screen. So my dears, I hope आप सभी लोग मेरी स्क्रीन देख पा रहे होंगे. सो माय डियर्स, बिफोर स्टार्टिंग टुडेज लेक्चर एट वन ग्लांस वी लाइक टू सी व्हाट वी लर्न इन लास्ट टू लेक्चर्स बट एट वेरी फास्टली विद इन फ्यू मिनट्स. सो इन लास्ट लेक्चर वी स्टार्ट एट हियर अबाउट दिस मैथमेटिकल मेथड एंड इन दैट मैथमेटिकल मेथड वी स्टडी अबाउट इंट्रोडक्शन, इट्स वेक्टर एनालिसिस, वेक्टर ऑपरेशन, a resolution of factor, and today we are going to learn new topic, which one is multiplication of factor. So what's actually we learn in that vector analysis? In vector analysis, we study about that scalar. What is scalar? Which can completely describe by the magnitude. Magnitude is nothing but a number and unit. Example is mass, time, temperature. Then we study actually about vectors. What is vectors? A physical quantity which need a number and unit, that is nothing but the magnitude, and as well as direction for its complete description. Okay, here magnitude and direction both are required for its complete description. That quantity is called as a vectors. Example, displacement, velocity, linear momentum, acceleration. Then here we also study about that difference between scalar and vector. Scalar, magnitude having only, vectors, magnitude as well as direction. Scalar can be added or subtracted according to the rule of algebra, simple algebra. Vectors can be added or subtracted by vector algebra. We are not used at a simple algebra. Here we are used vector algebra, that is vector law of addition or subtraction. Scalar can be represented, there is no specification, but vectors is represented by arrow. Okay, so in last lecture we also study about graphical representation by undirected arrow line. We can also shown by a single capital letter. If you take example of vector x, where x is its magnitude and above arrow shows its direction. As well as in last lecture we study about that definition, some definition, zero vector, a vector having zero magnitude but it's having particular direction. Equal vector, if you take two vectors having same type and both having magnitude and direction are same, then we can tell it's equal vector. Then we take some definitions also there, negative vector, resultant vector, position vector, as well as we study at here unit vectors. What is unit vector? A vector having unit magnitude, there is only one magnitude, but it's having direction. Which is its direction? In the same as the given vector, in the given direction of vector. a vector having unit magnitude in a given direction is called at your unit vector. Unit vector, it's having magnitude 1. We know that along x-axis there is a unit vector is I, along y-axis we take unit vector is j, and along z-axis we take at a unit vector is k. As well as in last lecture we study about that addition and subtraction of two vectors. If the two vectors same type and they are parallel, they are same direction, then we can add. If they are anti-parallel, then we can subtract to them. If they are in same direction and parallel, we can add. If they are opposite direction, anti-parallel, then we can subtract. If suppose there is two vectors, both are not parallel or anti-parallel, then we can add or subtract by using triangle of vector addition. You know, where first vector is completed, the second vector will start, and the resultant vector is third side of this triangle, which is start from the starting point of first vector and end at the ending point of second vector. So this is the resultant vector C is equal to vector A plus vector B, which we already studied in last lecture. This triangle law we can use for shows the vector addition is commutative. Vector addition is an associative. Then next important article we already studied at here, law parallelogram of vector. Law of parallelogram of vector. This article is really important for us. We take at here two vectors, vector P and vector Q. There is some angle between them. Then if you take a parallelogram, then its diagonal is nothing but the resultant vector, which is starting from the same point. So we already find out at here its magnitude also, and as well as direction. Magnitude kya hoga resultant vector ka? Yahan pe magnitude hota hai resultant vector ka, jo diagonal hai wo hota hai square root of p square plus q square plus 2pq cos theta. And what about its direction? Direction we can show by using angle alpha, which is equal to tan inverse in bracket q sine theta upon p plus q cos theta. Okay, my dears, here we take also some numericals on this article also, as well as we start at a new one article, which one is nothing but the resolution of vectors. We already studied in last lecture, resolution of vectors. What is the resolution? The process of splitting, separate karna, ek aise process. जिसमें वेक्टर को सेपरेट कर सकते हैं किसमें उसके कंपोनेंट में. इफ वी टेक एट वेक्टर आर, वी कैन स्प्लिट अप इनटू टू कंपोनेंट अलोंग एक्स एक्सिस वेक्टर आर एक्स एंड अलोंग वाई एक्सिस वी कैन टेक वेक्टर आर वाई. सो वी कैन राइट एट वेक्टर आर इज इक्वल टू वेक्टर आर एक्स प्लस वेक्टर आर वाई. एंड वी नो अबाउट इट्स यूनिट वेक्टर. वी कैन राइट एट वेक्टर आर इज इक्वल टू वेक्टर सॉरी वी कैन राइट एट वेक्टर आर इज इक्वल टू आर एक्स इनटू आई प्लस आर वाई इनटू जे. हियर वी आर आल्सो फाइंडिंग इट्स मैग्नीट्यूड. If suppose there is a three axis and there is a resultant vector, then its magnitude is nothing but the square root of rx square r plus ry square plus rz square. Okay, this is we already studied in last lecture along with its numerical. We take also some numericals on these articles. You can see last videos, SRT online lectures ke jo bhi videos hai, aap wo dekh sakte hai, usko understand kar sakte hai, doubt rahega. To please aap hum doubt solve karne ki koshish bhi karenge. So in last lecture we take some numericals also, and we studied up to resolution of vectors. Okay, today we are going to new article, which one is very important for us. Today we are learn at here about this production of vectors. Aaj hame yahan pe study karna hai production of vector ke bare mein. Today we are going to learn multiplication of vectors. आज हम यहां पे वेक्टर्स के बारे में स्टडी करना चाहते हैं, मल्टीप्लिकेशन के बारे में स्टडी करना चाहते हैं. क्या होता है मल्टीप्लिकेशन, कैसा होता है? चलो मान लो अगर मैं कोई एक स्केलर क्वांटिटी लेता हूं जस्ट लाइक मास, और उसको अगर मैं कोई वेक्टर क्वांटिटी से मल्टीप्लाई करता हूं जस्ट लाइक एक्सीलरेशन. वेक्टर क्वांटिटी, एक्सीलरेशन इज वेक्टर क्वांटिटी. मास इज अ स्केलर, एक्सीलरेशन इज वेक्टर. एंड इफ यू टेक इट्स मल्टीप्लिकेशन, देन वी ऑलवेज गेट वेक्टर क्वांटिटी. वी नो फोर्स. Force is nothing but the mass into acceleration. Force is nothing but the mass into acceleration. Where mass is scalar, acceleration is vector. Then we get answer is a vector. हमें क्या पता चला यहाँ से? अगर मैं कोई scalar quantity vector quantity से multiply करता हूँ तो उसका answer हमेशा vector आता है. Okay, got it? अगर मैं कोई scalar quantity vector quantity को के साथ मल्टीप्लीकेशन करता हूं तो हमेशा वेक्टर आता है. बट हो सकता है कि अगर सपोज मैं, चलो मान लो दो वेक्टर क्वांटिटी लेता हूं, Suppose I'm taking anti vector, vector A, okay, and I'm taking second vector, vector B. I'm taking anti two vector, okay. अब मैं यहाँ पे दो वेक्टर लेता हूं. अगर मैं सपोज ये दो वेक्टर का आंसर अगर मुझे स्केलर मिलता है, व्हाट आई एम सेइंग, इफ यू टेक एट ए टू वेक्टर एंड इफ यू टेक इट्स मल्टीप्लिकेशन एंड इफ यू गेट एट ए आंसर इज स्केलर, देन दैट प्रोडक्ट इज नथिंग बट दी कॉल इट ए स्केलर प्रोडक्ट एंड द स्केलर प्रोडक्ट इज शोन बाय दिस डॉट. अगर मैं दो वेक्टर का प्रोडक्ट मल्टीप्लीकेशन लेने के बाद अगर मुझे आंसर स्केलर मिलता है तो उस प्रोडक्ट को हम कहेंगे स्केलर प्रोडक्ट एंड स्केलर प्रोडक्ट वी कैन शोन बाय दिस डॉट. एक्चुअली डॉट इज नथिंग बट द ऑपरेटर इज देयर. ओके, अगर सपोज मैं यहां पे ये दो वेक्टर लेता हूं वेक्टर ए एंड वेक्टर बी और इनका मैं मल्टीप्लीकेशन लेता हूं और अगर मल्टीप्लीकेशन लेने के बाद अगर मुझे आंसर वेक्टर क्वांटिटी मिलती है तो उसे हम कहेंगे वेक्टर प्रोडक्ट और इट कैन ऑल्सो शोज एट हियर डॉट प्रोडक्ट. उसको ऑल्सो हम डॉट प्रोडक्ट भी कह सकते हैं, वेक्टर प्रोडक्ट या तो हम क्या कह सकते हैं उसको डॉट प्रोडक्ट. वी कैन से ऑल्सो एट हियर डॉट प्रोडक्ट ऑल्सो, सॉरी वी कैन से ऑल्सो क्रॉस प्रोडक्ट एट हियर. अगर सपोज मैं यहां पे दो वेक्टर का मल्टीप्लीकेशन लेने के बाद अगर स्केलर आंसर आता है तो इट इज स्केलर प्रोडक्ट which we can shown by at here dot. And agar suppose do vector ka main product lene ke baad agar mujhe vector quantity milti hai to wo hota hai cross product. Okay, which we learn today kaise hota hai kya hota hai iske bare mein hame yahan pe sochna hai. So today we are going to learn at here about this scalar product. So today we would like to learn about scalar product. To aaj hum zara scalar product ke bare mein study karna chahte hain and this scalar product is also called at here dot product. स्केलर प्रोडक्ट को हम क्या कहते हैं डॉट प्रोडक्ट, वेयर डॉट इज नथिंग बट द ऑपरेटर. डॉट यहां पे ऑपरेटर है और यहां पे मैं अगर मैं दो वेक्टर का प्रोडक्ट लेता हूं और अगर आंसर स्केलर आता है तो उसको हम स्केलर प्रोडक्ट कहेंगे या तो उसको हम कहेंगे डॉट प्रोडक्ट. क्या है फिर स्केलर प्रोडक्ट की डेफिनेशन, लेट्स सी केयरफुली. द स्केलर प्रोडक्ट और डॉट प्रोडक्ट of two non-zero vector, I'm taking at here two vector, both vector are non-zero, is defined as the product of magnitude of two vector, product of magnitude of two vectors and cosine of the angle theta between the two vector. If you take scalar product or dot product of the two non-zero vectors is defined as the product of magnitude of two vectors and cosine of the angle theta between the two vectors. Let's see carefully. Suppose I'm taking at two vectors, vector p and vector q. Chalo maan lo main yahan pe do vector leta hu, ek vector p leta hu aur ek vector q leta hu aur dono mein angle mein theta leta hu. Suppose I'm taking at here angle between them is theta, here vector p and vector q. And the angle between them is nothing but the theta. Theta is a small angle. If you see carefully at here vector p is non zero, matlab wo zero nahi hai and vector q is also not zero. Here this vector p and vector q both are non-zero and there is a some angle between them which is nothing but the theta. And if you take its scalar product which is also called dot product, agar chalo maan lo in do vectors ka agar mujhe scalar product lena hai ya to dot product lena hai to hame kya lena hoga, which is equal to kis equal hai product, kiska product, magnitude of this two vector. अगर मैं यहां पे इस p को देख रहा होगा तो ये p मैग्नीट्यूड है, किसका मैग्नीट्यूड है वेक्टर p का. अगर मैं इस q को देख रहा होगा तो ये q मैग्नीट्यूड है, किसका मैग्नीट्यूड है वेक्टर q का. तो दिस इज द प्रोडक्ट ऑफ मैग्नीट्यूड ऑफ दिस टू वेक्टर एंड कोसाइन ऑफ द एंगल बिटवीन देम. सो कीप इट इन ऑलवेज माइंड द स्केलर प्रोडक्ट और डॉट प्रोडक्ट ऑफ टू नॉन जीरो वेक्टर इज डिफाइंड एज और इज इक्वल टू the product of magnitude of two vectors and cosine of the angle between them. maine yahan pe vector liya vector p, maine yahan pe vector liya vector q aur dono ka main yahan pe scalar product leta hu, matlab dot product leta hu. to hame kya likhna hoga, hame likhna hoga product of magnitude of this two vector. I say magnitude means at here this is nothing but the modulus, this is nothing but the modulus of vector p, this is nothing but the modulus of vector p. Okay, this is nothing but the magnitude and this is nothing but the modulus of vector q. Aur ye kya hai modulus hai, kiska modulus hai vector q ka. This is nothing but the magnitude here, nothing more. तो हम यहाँ पे मैग्नीट्यूड्स लेंगे वेक्टर पे एंड वेक्टर क्यू का, एंड हम दोनों का बीच में एंगल कौन सा लेंगे, वेटे कैट या एंगल इज नथिंग बट द कोसाइन, कोसाइन ऑफ द एंगल बिटवीन दैट. ओके, सो दिस इज स्केलर प्रोडक्ट, प्रोडक्ट ऑफ मैग्नीट्यूड ऑफ टू वेक्टर एंड कोसाइन ऑफ द एंगल बिटवीन दैम. वी टेक सम एग्जांपल ऑफ द स्केलर प्रोडक्ट. फर्स्ट एग्जांपल इज एट हियर अबाउट वर्क, यू नो वर्क, सिंपल वर्क, वर्क इज नथिंग बट द फोर्स इनटू डिस्प्लेसमेंट. But we know force. Force is a vector quantity. And S, S is nothing but the displacement quantity. Your force and displacement both are vectors. Your force and displacement both are vectors. And if you take its product, we get scalar quantity, which is nothing but the work. Work is a scalar quantity. Force is a vector quantity. Displacement is a vector quantity, and if you take its product, then we get at here work is a scalar quantity, and hence we take at a scalar product between force and displacement. So work is a scalar product of force vector F and displacement vector S. We take also second example of this scalar product. We know about power. Power is a scalar product of force vector F and velocity vector v. Vector f is nothing but a vector quantity. Vector v is a vector quantity, which is velocity. So if you take its product, then we get scalar quantity, which is the power. And hence we take at here scalar product between force and velocity. Power, we know about power. What is power? The rate of doing work with respect to time. पावर मतलब क्या होता है, वर्क अपॉन टाइम, वी नो अबाउट दैट. पावर, पावर इज नथिंग बट द वर्क अपॉन टाइम. सो इफ यू टेक एट हियर पावर, पावर इज नथिंग बट द वर्क अपॉन टाइम. सो वी नो अबाउट वर्क, वर्क इज नथिंग बट द फोर्स इनटू डिस्प्लेसमेंट. वी नो अबाउट फोर्स इनटू डिस्प्लेसमेंट. ओके, फोर्स एफ, डिस्प्लेसमेंट एस एंड अपॉन टी. बट वी नो अबाउट डिस्प्लेसमेंट अपॉन टाइम. डिस्प्लेसमेंट अपॉन टाइम इज नथिंग बट द वेलोसिटी. सो वी कैन राइट एट हियर दिस नथिंग बट द एफ इनटू वी. सो वी कैन टेक एट हियर एफ इनटू वी. बट वी नो दैट एफ इज अ वेक्टर क्वांटिटी, velocity is also vector quantity, and if you take its scalar product, then we get answer is a power, which is a scalar quantity. So here power is a scalar quantity. So this is the example of the scalar product. First example is work, which is a scalar product of force and displacement. Second quantity is power, which is the scalar product of force and velocity. Now we like to learn, we will like to study about characteristic of scalar product. अभी हमें यहाँ पे study करना है characteristic. किसकी characteristic? Scalar product की. क्या है characteristic? We say at you one by one. We study one by one. Don't worry. So look at here. The scalar product of two vectors. Look at this first characteristic, and then हम उसके बाद में diagram के तरफ जाएंगे. The scalar product of two vectors. मैं यहाँ पे scalar product लेता हूँ दो vectors का. वो किससे equivalent है? Is equivalent to the product of magnitude of one vector. देखो product है. किसके साथ product है? Magnitude. किसका magnitude? First vector का. किसके साथ है लेकिन उसका product? With the magnitude of the component. Component. Component किसका? Other vector का. But ये other vector का component किसके direction में है? In the direction of first vector. Once again, I'm repeating this characteristic. The scalar product of two vector. मैं scalar product ले रहा हूँ दो vectors का. वो equivalent है. किससे equivalent है? Product से. किसका product है? Magnitude of first vector. किसके साथ है? With the magnitude of component of other vector. In the direction of first. But ये जो component है दूसरे vector का, वो किसके direction में है? First vector के direction में. Look at here. Don't worry. So I'm taking at here vector p dot vector q, which is nothing but the pq cos theta. So p, this q cos theta, we can write at here this. Okay, before that I would like to tell at here about this diagram. Chalo main simple se diagram se aapko batata hu, mujhe pata hai, hum zara koshish karte hain. Suppose I'm taking at here this vector p, this is the vector p, then I'm taking at here vector q, I'm taking this vector q. Okay, this is vector q. Now, from this vector q, I will like to draw perpendicular on vector p. अब vector q से मैं perpendicular draw करता हूँ. कहाँ पे perpendicular draw कर रहा हूँ? Vector p पे. Suppose this is the angle between them. This is the theta. Okay. This is vector q. Vector q having two component. First component is along x-axis, which is vector qx. This is vector qx component along x-axis, vector qx. Okay, and here is nothing but the y-axis, which is y component, no doubt. So this is the right angle. This is the right angle. Okay, suppose this is nothing but the vector q. So we can write at a cos theta. Hum cos theta kya likh payenge fir? So we can write at a cos theta. Cos theta is nothing but the adjacent side. Adjacent side is nothing but the qx. And hypotenuse. Look at that hypotenuse. If this is the right angle, agar ye right angle hai, toh hypotenuse this vector ho jayega, vector q ho jayega. So we can write at it this vector q or q. So can I write at it this qx? Qx is nothing but the kya hoga fir? So we can write at a qx. Qx is nothing but the q. Q is divide, goes that side, multiply. So we can write at here q into cos theta. Q into cos theta. So if you see carefully toward this qx, qx is nothing but the q into cos theta. Look at here, q into cos theta. This q into cos theta is nothing but the qx. So you can write it here. This is nothing but the p into qx. P into qx. What is qx component? Kiska component hai? Vector q ka. Kiske direction mein hai? Ye qx dekho, component hai. Kiska component hai? Vector q ka. But kiske direction mein hai? Vector p ke direction mein hai. So if you see carefully at here, we can write at here vector p dot vector q is equal to p into qx. What is qx? Component. Kiska component? Vector q ka. Kiske direction mein hai? Vector p ke direction mein hai. Look at it here. If you see carefully toward this diagram, this is the vector p, ye vector p hai. And this is the vector q, ye vector q hai. And from vector q, we'll draw perpendicular. Ye perpendicular humne draw kiya hai. This is the right angle triangle. This is the angle theta. Then obviously cos theta. Cos theta is nothing but the qx upon q. Cos theta is nothing but the adjacent side. This is the qx upon this q. So we can write it qx is equal to q cos theta. And this q cos theta is nothing but the qx. Where qx is nothing but the component. Kiska component hai? Q ka. Kiske direction mein hai? Vector p ke direction mein hai. And yehi humne yahan pe likhne ki koshish ki hai. Kya study kiya hai humne? Scalar product. Vector p and vector q. Is equivalent. Kis equivalent hai? Is equivalent. Product. Kiska product hai? Magnitude of one vector. Dekho vector p ka magnitude p hai. Magnitude of one vector. With the kiske saath hai? Magnitude of component. Dekho ye qx. Magnitude hai. Kiska component hai? Of the other vector. Dusre vector ka. Component of vector q. But kiske direction mein? In the direction of first. First vector kaun sa hai? Vector p. Uska direction kis mein hai? Vector p ke direction mein hai. So vector p dot vector q is equal to p into component of vector q in the direction of vector p. Okay. In the same manner, hum kya likh sakte hain? Usi tarike se hum kya likh sakte hain next? Hence, in the same manner, we can take at here component of vector p. Hum usi tarike se p ka component le sakte hain along vector q. Look at here. This is the vector p. Ye vector p hai. Aur wahan se humne perpendicular draw kiya hai. Kahan pe perpendicular draw kiya hai? On vector q. So this is the theta. We know cos theta. Adjacent side upon hypotenuse, this is the vector p, cos theta. So cos theta is nothing but the we know about opposite, adjacent side upon hypotenuse. Yahan pe theta hai, ye right angle hai. This is the adjacent side. This is the adjacent side, which is nothing but the px and upon hypotenuse. And hypotenuse is nothing but the this vector p. So we can write at px. Px kya ho jayega fir? So px is nothing but the p into cos theta, p into cos theta. A p into cos theta is nothing but the component of px. Aur yahi humne yahan pe likhne ki koshish ki hai. Look at it. So isse hum kya likh sakte hain? Isko hum likh sakte hain fir q into px. Q into px. Okay, what is q? Q is nothing but the magnitude, which is the second vector. And what is px? Px is nothing but the component. Component kiska hai? Vector p ka hai. Kiske direction mein hai? Vector q ke direction mein hai. So my dear friends, my dear student, what do we learn in this characteristic? In this characteristic, we learn the scalar product of two vector is equivalent to the product of magnitude of one vector with the magnitude of the component of other vector in the direction of first vector. Okay, this is the first number characteristic. Now, second number characteristic. The scalar product. Obey means follow. Commutative law. Vector multiplication. Commutative law. This scalar product obeys the commutative law of vector multiplication. Means if you take at a vector p dot vector q, then we can write it a PQ cos theta. This is the magnitude. Ye magnitude hai. अगर मैं स्केलर प्लॉट लेता हूं वेक्टर पी एंड वेक्टर क्यू का, तो हम क्या लिख सकते हैं? पी इंटू क्यू इंटू कॉस थीटा. वी कैन ऑल्सो राइट एट हियर क्यू इंटू पी. इट्स मैग्नीट्यूड ओनली, दिस इज मैग्नीट्यूड ओनली, सो वी कैन राइट एट हियर पी इंटू क्यू और क्यू इंटू पी कॉस थीटा. सो इफ यू सी केयरफुली क्यू इंटू पी कॉस थीटा, दिस इज नथिंग बट द वेक्टर क्यू डॉट वेक्टर पी. सो इफ यू सी इन वेल मैनर वेक्टर पी डॉट वेक्टर क्यू, वी कैन ऑल्सो राइट एट हियर वेक्टर क्यू डॉट वेक्टर पी. दिस इज नथिंग बट द कम्यूटेटिव लॉ of vector multiplication. Scalar product obeys, follow करता है commutative law of vector multiplication. Scalar product का answer scalar आता है, hence it can follow or obey this commutative law of vector multiplication. Now the scalar product also obey distributive law of multiplication. Distributive जो bracket को distribute करता है. So if you take at a vector p dot in bracket vector q plus vector r, we are take at a three vectors. So we can distribute this bracket. So we can write it a vector p dot vector q plus vector p dot vector r. This scalar product obeys the distributive law of multiplication. Okay. Now fourth one characteristic is that scalar product of vector with itself is equal to the square of its magnitude. How? Look at here. चलो मान लो मैं वेक्टर पी लेता हूं और उसका स्केलर प्रोडक्ट मैं वेक्टर पी के साथ ही लेता हूं. मैं स्केलर प्रोडक्ट लेता हूं किसका? वेक्टर का. किसके साथ? विद इटसेल्फ. आई एम टेकिंग एट अ स्केलर प्रोडक्ट. किसका? वेक्टर का. किसके साथ? विद इटसेल्फ के साथ. वो क्या होगा? स्क्वायर होगा. किसका स्क्वायर होगा? उसका मैग्नीट्यूड का. हाउ? कैसे? लुक एट हियर वेक्टर पी डॉट वेक्टर पी, तो इसको हम कैसे लिखेंगे? वेक्टर पी का मैग्नीट्यूड पी, वेक्टर पी का मैग्नीट्यूड पी कॉस थीटा. कोई भी वेक्टर मेकिंग एंगल जीरो विथ इटसेल्फ, एनी वेक्टर मेक्स एंगल जीरो विथ इटसेल्फ. कोई भी वेक्टर खुद के साथ जीरो एंगल प्रोड्यूस करता है, इट्स पैरेलल टू इट्स ओन सेल्फ. सो इफ यू सी केयरफुली p into cos theta, सो यू कैन राइट एट p into p cos zero. Cos zero इज नथिंग बट द वन. वी नो cos zero इज नथिंग बट द वन. सो p into one means p into p. दिस इज मैग्नीट्यूड ओनली. So p into p is nothing but the p square. The scalar product of vector with itself is equal to the square of its magnitude. This is the fourth number one. Then fifth number characteristic. Fifth number one is that if two non-zero vectors are parallel to each other, if you take at it two vectors, vector p and vector q, both are non-zero. This is the most important. Both vectors are non-zero vectors and they are parallel to each other. If they are parallel to each other, then how many angle between them? Obviously zero. If two vectors are parallel to each other, then its scalar product is equal to the product of magnitude of these two vector. Agar suppose main do vectors leta hu, vector p and vector q, dono vector ek dusre ko parallel hai, matlab unke beech mein angle zero hai, to uska answer kya hoga? To hame uska answer milega product. Kiska product? Magnitude of these two vector. How? Look at here. Vector p dot vector q. We can write it here. Vector p, its magnitude is p. Vector q, its magnitude is q. And cos theta. So p q cos theta. Theta is nothing but the zero. So cos zero. We know cos zero. Cos zero is nothing but the one. If cos zero is one, so we can write it here p into q into one means p q. The scalar product of two non-zero vectors which are parallel to each other, then its scalar product is nothing but the product of magnitude of this two vector. Okay, if they are parallel, if they are anti-parallel, then what does that mean? Anti-parallel. Here, this two vector anti-parallel. Anti-parallel means both vector are parallel, no doubt, but their opposite direction. But unki direction kya hoti hai? Opposite. Anti-parallel. There is an angle between them is nothing but the 180 degree. So this is vector p, this is vector q, and there is nothing but the angle between them is nothing but the 180. They are anti-parallel. Okay, then what is its answer? So vector p dot vector q is nothing but the p q cos theta. Vector p ka magnitude p hai, vector q ka magnitude q hai, and then cos theta. Okay, so p q cos 180 degree. We know cos 180 or cos pi is nothing but the minus one. Cos 180 or cos pi is nothing but the minus one. So you can write that here minus p q. Okay, if two non-zero vectors are anti-parallel to each other, then its scalar product is negative product of magnitude of this two vector. Negative product. Kiska product? Magnitude of this two vector. Vector p ka magnitude p, vector q ka magnitude q. So minus pq. If they are only parallel, then product of magnitude of this two vector. If they are anti-parallel, then its scalar product is negative product of magnitude of this two vector. Okay, if suppose both vector are perpendicular to each other, then suppose I'm taking here two vector, both vector are non-zero. If two non-zero vectors are perpendicular to each other, means how many angle between them? 90 degree. If both vectors are perpendicular to each other, then what about its scalar product? This is the most important characteristic. Never forget. My dears, this is the most important characteristic. If suppose I'm taking at here two vectors and both vectors are perpendicular to each other, suppose yahan pe main do vector leta hu aur dono vector ek dusre ko agar perpendicular hai to, then its scalar product is equal to zero. To uska scalar product kya ho jayega? Zero hoga. How? Look at here. Suppose I'm taking at a vector p, vector q, scalar product or dot product, then we can write at here pq cos 90. Why? Because their angle between them is nothing but the 90 degree. So we can write at a pq cos 90. We know cos 90 is nothing but the zero. Cos 90 is zero. So you can write at a pq zero. Pq zero means nothing but the zero. P into q into zero, that is nothing but the zero. If you take two non-zero vectors and both are perpendicular to each other, then its scalar product is zero. Never forget. Iska alternate statement kya hoga? Agar suppose main do vectors leta hu aur dono perpendicular hai, to iska scalar product kya hoga? Zero, obviously. अगर मैं दो वेक्टर्स लेता हूं और दोनों वेक्टर्स एक दूसरे को अगर परपेंडिकुलर है तो उनका स्केलर प्रोडक्ट क्या होगा? जीरो. इट मींस दे आर परपेंडिकुलर. इफ टू नॉन जीरो वेक्टर्स आर परपेंडिकुलर टू ईच अदर, देन इट्स स्केलर प्रोडक्ट इज इक्वल टू जीरो. ओके, देन वी टेक एट हियर स्केलर प्रोडक्ट ऑफ रेक्टेंगुलर यूनिट वेक्टर्स. We know about that. Along x-axis, there is a unit vector is I. Along y-axis, unit vector is j. Along z-axis, there is a unit vector is k. I, j, k. Okay, if you take I dot I, अगर मैं यूनिट वेक्टर I का स्केलर प्रोडक्ट I के साथ ही लेता हूं तो I का मैग्नीट्यूड 1. I का मैग्नीट्यूड 1. Why? It is unit vector. Unit vector having unit magnitude. Cos theta. Unit vector I makes angle 0 with itself. So obviously cos 0 is 0. Cos 0 is 1. So 1 into 1 into 1, obviously it's nothing but the 1. If you take I dot I, if you take I dot I, then its answer is 1. J dot J, answer is 1. K dot K is answer is 1. So we can write that here, I dot I is equal to J dot J is equal to K dot K is equal to 1. Okay, if you take scalar product I and J, I dot J, how many angle between them? 90. Okay. Look at here, I dot J, I ka magnitude 1, J ka magnitude 1, cos 90. We know cos 90, 0. So 1 into 1 into 0 is nothing but the 0. So I dot J is 0. If I dot J is 0, then obviously J dot I is also 0. Why? Because they are mutually perpendicular. If I dot J is 0, J dot I is also 0. J dot K is 0, K dot J is 0. K dot I is 0, I dot K is 0. Your x, y, z axis are mutually perpendicular to each other. If you take two unit vectors and they are perpendicular, then its scalar product is zero. Or if you take a unit vector, its scalar product with itself, then its answer is one. I dot I is equal to J dot J is equal to K dot K is equal to one. I dot J is zero, J dot I is zero. Okay. Then here we can show by using this chart. IJK, IJK, I cross I, 0, I cross J, 0, sorry, I dot I, 1, I dot J, 0, I dot K, 0, J dot I, 0, J dot J, 1, J dot K, 0, K dot I, 0, K dot J, 0, K dot K, 1. Okay, we'll go ahead then. Ab yahan pe hum kya lenge next? The next content, characteristic is here, scalar product of vector expressed in terms of rectangular component. यहां पे हम रेक्टेंगुलर कंपोनेंट्स लेंगे. वी टेक एट हियर रेक्टेंगुलर कंपोनेंट, देखते हैं. चलो मैं लेता हूं यहां पे वेक्टर p. वेक्टर p इज नथिंग बट द pxi + pyj + pzk. नाउ द नेक्स्ट वेक्टर इज वेक्टर q इज इक्वल टू qxi + qyj + qzk. हियर वी टेक टू वेक्टर्स, वी कैन एक्सप्रेस इन रेक्टेंगुलर कंपोनेंट. लुक एट हाउ वेक्टर p डॉट वेक्टर q इज नथिंग बट द pxqx + pyqy + pzqz. वी वांट टू शो दिस इक्वेशन, हमें ये इक्वेशन को शो करना है. So we take scalar product, look at here, vector p, pxi plus pyj plus pzk, scalar product with vector q, qxi plus qyj plus qzk. Okay, then, सबसे पहले हम ये pxi का scalar product इस पूरे bracket के साथ लेंगे. Then, pyj का scalar product हम पूरे bracket के साथ लेंगे. Then, pzk का scalar product हम इस पूरे bracket के साथ लेंगे. तो देखो हमने कैसे लिखा है, pxi in bracket this qxi plus qyj plus qzk. Next one is that plus pyj is equal to qxi plus qyj plus qzk. The next pzk in bracket qxi plus qyj plus qzk. Okay, if it's in well manner at here, this unit vector having direction, this unit vector having direction, then we take scalar product of this unit vector. Here px is magnitude of x component of vector p, qx is magnitude of x component of vector q. Its magnitude, so we can write it here, i pxqx plus i dot j pxqy plus i dot k pxqz, then plus j dot I pyqx plus j dot j pyqy plus j dot k pyqz plus k dot I pzqx plus k dot j pzqy plus k dot k pzqz. We know I dot I is 1, j dot j is 1, k dot k is 1, and other one is 0. Then what we can write at here? So we can write at here, i dot i is equal to j dot j is equal to k dot k is 0. And if you take at here, I dot j, j dot k, k dot I, these all factors are 0. If you put this value, then we get answer at here, 1 into pxqx plus 0 into pxqy plus 0 into pxqz plus 0 into pyqx plus 1 into pyqy plus 0 into pyqz plus 0 into pzqx plus 0 into pzqy plus 1 into pzqz. Then we get answer at here, vector p dot vector q is equal to pxqx plus pyqy plus pzqz. This is the most important, never forget. ये हमें न्यूमेरिकल के लिए चाहिए, मोस्टली इन JEE, इन CET, इन नीट एग्जाम. दिस इक्वेशन इज वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट फॉर अस. वेक्टर p डॉट वेक्टर q इज इक्वल टू pxqx प्लस pyqy प्लस pzqz. तो दिस इज द कैरेक्टरिस्टिक ऑफ द स्केलर प्रोडक्ट, ये कैरेक्टरिस्टिक है. वी टेक एट योर वन न्यूमेरिकल. फर्स्ट लुक एट योर वेक्टर क्वांटिटी फोर्स. वेक्टर f इज इक्वल टू 4i + 6j + 3k, व्हिच इज द न्यूटन. फोर्स इज इन न्यूटन. Acting on particle produces a displacement vector s. Look at that displacement, 2i plus 2j plus 5j. Find, the displacement is in meter. Find is work done by the force. So how we can solve it? Force is given, displacement is given, and we want to find out at here work. So work W is equal to force into displacement. So we can write it here, force and displacement. So then 4 into 2 plus 6 into 3 plus 3 into 5. जैसे हमने लिखा था ना, यहाँ पे हम क्या लिख सकते हैं, fx ss plus fy sy plus fz sz in the same manner. So if you see carefully, what do we get at here? We get at here 4 into 2, 4 2 is 8 plus 6 3 is 18 plus 3 5 is 15. If you add at here, then we get at here 41 joule. In the same manner, we can take at a second numerical, which one is last numerical here. Oh, they are given a vector v1, 5i plus 2j, and v2, ai minus 6j, and both are perpendicular. Given is that both are perpendicular. So determine value of a. हमें a की value find करनी है, जो a हमने यहाँ पे लिखा है v2 में लिखा है, जो i के साथ है. Okay, how we can find out? Both are perpendicular. If both are perpendicular, then obviously scalar product is zero. We know scalar product क्या हो जाएगा, जीरो. मींस vector v1 dot vector v2 is 0 means v1x into v2x plus v1y into v2y. So if you place their component, then look at here, vector, v1x, v1 is nothing but the, v1x is nothing but the 5, v2x, v2x is nothing but the a, plus v1y, v1y is nothing but the 2, v2y, v2y is nothing but the minus 6. So its scalar product is 0. Why? Because they are perpendicular. Then what we can write at here? We can write at here, 5 into a, 5a, 2 into minus 6, means minus 12 is equal to 0. Okay, then 5a is equal to 12. Yaha pe minus hai 12, another side jayega to plus hoga. So a is equal to 12 upon 5. Yeah, we can show at here a is equal to 2.4. So my dears, here we study about this scalar product and some numerical. So yahan pe dekha hai scalar product ki numericals. Scalar product ke sabse pehle humne definition study ki hai, which is the product of magnitude of this term, cosine of the angle theta between the two vectors. So vector p dot vector q is equal to pq cos theta. Yahan pe examples le scalar, okay? Just like walk is a scalar product of vector force, displacement, power is a scalar product of force and velocity. Humne yahan pe characteristic study kiya. Scalar product obeys commutative law of vector multiplication. Scalar product obeys distributive law of multiplication. Scalar product of vector with itself is nothing but the square of its magnitude. If you take two non-zero vectors, they are parallel, then its scalar product is equal to product of magnitude of these two vectors. If these two vectors are anti-parallel to each other, then its scalar product is equal to negative product of magnitude of these two vectors. If suppose these two vectors are perpendicular to each other, then its scalar product is zero. Then scalar product of unit vectors, I dot I, J dot J, K dot K is one, and other one is zero. Then scalar product can be expressed in terms of rectangular form. Vector p dot vector q is equal to px qx plus py qy plus pz qz. And we try to solve it here some numericals. Actually, we take only two numericals. Hame koshish karni thi ki hum kam se kam four numericals le sake. But due to time limits, I would like to go toward our SART team. So I would like to stop my sharing my ideas and the remaining parts and the vector product. Next one is vector product, which is also important article, just like scalar product. We'll study in next lecture. So I would like to hand over toward this SART team. Mr. Abhinav sir. Hello, respected Vaghmare sir. Thank you, SART team, and thank you, Professor Madhuri Tita ma'am, for help me. Thank you.
Okay, Prashant sir. Prashant sir, thank you. Okay, Jayan sir, over to you. Your session is now started.
Good morning to all of you. So I am Mr. Jayan
Vaghmare. Good morning, sir.
I am Mr. Jayan Vaghmare from Kirti College, Dadar, Mumbai. So, students, let us begin with our today's lecture. As you know well, in the previous lecture, we started with a chapter called Some Basic Concepts of Chemistry, right? Since there was a gap of few days in between, I would like to revise in short and then we'll go further. In this Some Basic Concept of Chemistry chapter, we discuss what is the meaning of chemistry, what is the matter, right? Then we discuss physical properties, we discuss various units, which are used to measure the physical quantities. Then we discuss laws of chemical combination, right? So that we discussed earlier. Our today lecture begin with the topic called atomic mass. Now, suppose for example, if I say atomic mass of sodium, or I say mass of sodium atom is 23, if I say that way, so indirectly I am referring to term called atomic mass, right? Mass of sodium atom is 23. That means it is the atomic mass of sodium atom. You can just go through what is given in the slide. every element has a characteristic atomic mass. Okay, right? This mass earlier we used to express in term with comparison to a hydrogen atom. But moment the isotopes of hydrogen were discovered, as you know well, 1H1, 1H2, 1H3, then the problem was started. And that's why that was replaced. That was replaced. Hydrogen was replaced by a new element called carbon 12. New unit for carbon 12. For example, now this is that. Okay. Students, I will correlate this situation with our day-to-day examples. Suppose if I say my body weight is 50 kg, that means I am heavier 50 times to 1 kg. Am I right? I repeat again, if my body weight is 50 kilogram, that means I am 50 times heavier to 1 kg. That 1 kg is the standard used for reference. So likewise, earlier we used to use hydrogen for comparison. Now we started with carbon 12 for comparison. It is as per the IUPAC norms. Okay, it is the internationally based organization IUPAC, and they have formulated rules and regulation. Okay, now look here. In this system, an atom of carbon 12 assign a mass of exactly 12. Atomic mass unit AMU, and all other atoms of other elements are given a relative atomic mass to that of carbon 12. That means always we compare the mass of atom with reference to carbon 12 atom mass. Okay, now look at the next slide here. Now here the atomic masses are expressed in AMU, as I said earlier. One AMU, if you want to know the meaning of one AMU, that is defined as a mass exactly equal to 1/12 of mass of one carbon C12 atom. Now, if you look at this simplification, which is seen here in the slide, it goes something like this. Here, 1 AMU is equal to 1/12 into mass of carbon 12. The mass of carbon 12, this is what taken for comparison. This mass of carbon 12 atom is how much? It is 1.992648 into 10^-23 gram. Now, if I simplify this value, that means 1.9926 upon 12, the answer coming down to this much. And the final answer is your 1.66056 into 10^-24 gram. This is very important conversion. You should remember 1 AMU is equal to 1.66056 into 10^-24 grams. Because this conversion, perhaps you will require while solving the problem. Now, this AMU, now what is given here? Recently, AMU, that is atomic mass unit, has been replaced by unified mass unit. Can you see here the small u? The small u unit stands for unified mass unit, or it can be also denoted by symbol DA. DA stands for Dalton. DA stand for Dalton. You know, time to time, the things keep on changing. Say 5 years back, 10 years back, we used to express a mass in terms of AMU. Now we will express the same mass, atomic mass, in terms of unified mass or in terms of Dalton. Okay, now that is about the atomic mass. Now, let us go to the next slide. Hoping that there is no problem, let us go ahead. Now, we are talking about average atomic mass. Now you will say, sir, atomic mass is okay. We understood about atomic mass, that is the mass of one atom of element. But then what is average atomic mass? Students, let me tell you, recently isotopes were discovered. Isotopes, some elements, they exist in the nature in the form of isotopes. Now see here what is given here. Many naturally occurring elements exist as a mixture of more than one isotopes. Now, you should know the meaning of isotope. Okay. Perhaps in your school days, you must have studied the meaning of isotopes. Okay. But definitely, I am going to tell you the meaning of isotope. Even if you do not know, I will tell you the meaning of isotopes. Because, you know, I told you isotopes of hydrogen were discovered 1H1, 1H2, 1H3, like O16, O17, O18. Right, so isotopes were discovered, and that's why it was need to consider average atomic mass. You know, isotopes were discovered, that is why this was required to define what is average atomic mass. Now, atomic mass of such an element is a weighted average of atomic mass of its isotopes, okay, taking into account the atomic mass of isotope and their relative abundance. Now, what you see in this slide, it can be clarified quite well in my next slide. Now, before that, let me tell you, some student may not be knowing meaning of isotopes, right? So meaning is there. Can just go through the meaning. Isotopes are the different atoms of same element having same atomic number but different mass number. Examples are in front of you. Carbon, element carbon exists in the form of three different isotopes. One is carbon C6-12, C6-13, and C6-14. Now, in that, if you want to know, this 6 is atomic number of carbon, and 12 is atomic mass of carbon. 12 carbon here, this is atomic mass 13, this is atomic mass 14. Okay, so as per the meaning of isotopes, different, they are having different mass number. Mass number different, 12, 13, 14, but atomic number remains same. And they are basically different atom of same element. So we can call them as isotopes. Just go through the slide properly, get acquainted with the meaning of isotopes. I'm pretty sure key in the chapter called structure of atom, you will once again study this concept called isotopes. Okay, so that is about meaning of isotopes. In fact, in the due course of time, you will come across various isotopes. Okay, now let us go ahead and talk about average atomic mass. Now, see, carbon, I have mentioned the carbon exists in three different forms of isotopes, C12, C13, C14, right? So C12 having atomic mass equal to 12 unified mass, C13 having atomic mass 13.00335 unified mass, carbon 14 having 14.00317 unified mass. And if you look at the relative abundance, in the previous slide, the reference was came relative abundance. Carbon 12 occur near about 98.892%. Carbon 13 occurs in the nature up to 1.108%, and carbon 14 occur in the nature in the range 2×10⁻¹. This is the relative abundance of these three isotopes. Right. So I told you the meaning of isotope. I gave you the example. I quote the atomic masses of three isotopes along with their relative abundance. Go through this data properly. Now, one thing you must have realized, carbon 14 relative abundance is very, very less. right? Carbon 12 is maximum. And then second come carbon 13. Okay. So, you know, I was referring to this in the previous slide. In the previous slide, see here, look here. Go through the panel. Is the weighted average atomic mass of its isotopes, taking into account the atomic masses. We consider atomic mass, we consider relative abundance, we consider both of them, right? Relative abundance and the you can say atomic mass, right? So that is what we were talking about. Now, next. Students, this is the example which I want to give here. Now, you know that neon exists in the form of three different isotopes. Neon having three isotopes, neon atomic number 10, mass number 20, neon atomic number 10, mass number 21, neon atomic number 10, mass number 22. So here, atomic number of neon is fixed, that is 10, but the mass number keep on changing, 20, 21, 22. So they are the isotopes of neon. Look at the atomic mass. Atomic mass of neon is given here, check. Neon 20, atomic mass 19.9924 unified mass. Neon 21, atomic mass 20.9940 unified mass. Neon 22, atomic mass equal to 21.9914 unified mass. Natural abundance is already given here. Neon 20 occurring in nature 90.92%, neon 21 0.26%, and neon 22 occurring in nature in the up to 8.82%. Okay, so this is what given. Now students, so now the question comes in mind. Suppose if I ask you, can you tell me the atomic mass of neon? Can you tell me the atomic mass of neon? So you will get puzzled. This is what I should report here. Should I report 20? Should I report 21? Or should I report 22? So in that case, to overcome this trouble, what we should do, you know, we should take average of all the three atomic masses. Now, see here, the calculation is already done here. You can see the calculation. Average mass, atomic mass of neon can be calculated by following way. Atomic mass of neon 20 into percentage of occurrence, atomic mass of neon 21 into percentage of occurrence, atomic mass of neon 22 into percentage of their occurrence, and upon 100. So what I've done, I substitute the value 19.9924 here, occurrence is 90.92 plus 20.9940 unified mass into occurrence 0.26 plus 21.9914 into 8.82 and divide by 100. And if I simplify this whole thing, you know, the answer is coming down to 20.1707, right? So if you want to quote the atomic mass of neon, you can say it is 20.1707 unified mass, okay? So this is what average atomic mass. This is the way you should calculate average atomic mass of element which occur in the form of different isotopes. Okay, definitely we will solve problem based upon this formula in a due course of time, right? So this is the way you can calculate average atomic mass. Very, very simple it is. Now, let us go to the next part of the topic. Here it comes. Yes. Now we talked about atomic mass. Now let us talk about molecular mass. When I'm talking about mass of an atom, we are talking about atomic mass. And when we are talking about mass of molecule, we are talking about molecular mass. The things are, given in a very easy manner. Just go through what is given here. molecular mass of a substance is the sum of average atomic mass of all the atoms of element which constitute the molecule. Right? So whenever we consider molecular mass of substance, we consider average atomic mass of all the atoms of the element which constitute the molecule. I will give one example here. Suppose I am going to discuss, if I want to calculate molecular mass of sodium chloride. So what I will do? I will consider atomic mass of sodium. I will consider atomic mass of chlorine also. And when I add them together, I will get a molecular mass. Now, as usual, similar to atomic mass, molecular mass is also can be expressed in with comparison to mass of carbon 12 atom, Please have a look. Molecular mass of substance is the mass of one molecule of that substance relative to the mass of one carbon 12 atom. That means whether it is atomic mass or whether it is molecular mass, it is always expressed with comparison to mass of carbon 12 atom. Because that is what decided by IUPAC, which is an international based organization, and they formulate rules and regulation time to time. Okay, now how to get molecular mass? It is obtained by multiplying average atomic mass of each element by the number of its atom and adding them together. Just now I said, if I'm going to calculate molecular mass of sodium chloride, I must add atomic mass of sodium and atomic mass of chlorine together, right? And if suppose out of those two elements, if anybody exists in the form of isotope, then we should consider average atomic mass, okay? Now, look at the next slide here. Now, example, carbon dioxide. Students, you must be knowing molecular mass of carbon dioxide is 44. If someone asks you, okay, what is the molecular mass of carbon dioxide? So you will say randomly, it is 44, right? But how that 44 is calculated? Yeah, the answer is given here. See, molecular mass of substance is the mass of one molecule of that substance related to the mass of one carbon 12 atom. Now, students, here CO2 we have one carbon atom, so we took 1 into average atomic mass of carbon. Now you will say, why average atomic mass you took here? Because we know that carbon exists in the three different isotopic form, and that's why average has to be considered. And I told you the calculation 5 minutes back. Average atomic mass of carbon is 12.0 unified mass. Okay. And O2, in CO2, there are two oxygen. So 2 into average atomic mass of oxygen. So 2 into 16. Again, you will say, why you took average atomic mass of oxygen here? Because even oxygen exists in three different isotopic form. That is O16, O17, and O18. And that's why we have to consider average atomic mass of oxygen. And that average atomic mass of oxygen is 16. Now 1 into 12, that is 12. 2 into 16, that is 32. 32 plus 12, that becomes 44. So this is what molecular mass of carbon dioxide, 44 unified mass. Remember, this is the way you can calculate. This is the way we can calculate molecular mass. Okay, so that is about the molecular mass. Next things, let us talk about another concept which we come across in this chapter, and that title is formula mass. You must be wondering here, okay, sir, we know about atomic mass, we heard about molecular mass, then what is about the formula mass? What is the formula mass? The meaning is in front of you. Formula mass of a substance, is the sum of the atomic masses of the atom present in the formula, right? In the formula. So always while calculating formula mass, you should consider atoms present in the given formula. Now, remember, suppose I'm taking this example, sodium chloride. Sodium chloride, right? We know that sodium chloride is ionic compound. It is made up of one sodium ion, one chloride ion, right? So when these two ions combine together, we get sodium chloride. Now, in sodium chloride structure, in sodium chloride crystal, we have one Na plus ion surrounded by six Cl minus ion, right? All the same distance, all are present at equal distance and vice versa. Therefore, NaCl is just formula used to present NaCl, right? Now look here. Look here. Now, just now I have mentioned you ki one sodium ion is surrounded by six chloride ion, right? Now, thus, what you see here, it is a three-dimensional image. So, you have to visualize it, okay? You have to visualize this structure. Now, for example, I'm talking about this. Suppose this is the sodium ion, Na plus ion, right? On left side, there is one Cl minus ion. On right side, there is a Cl minus ion. So, 1 plus 1, 2. One is upside, Cl minus. One is on downside, Cl minus. Right? So they are four. And this is the fifth one. Can you see our fifth? And this is the sixth one. So remember, one Na plus ion is surrounded by six Cl minus ion. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and 6th. So remember, one Na plus ion is surrounded by six Cl minus ion. Right, and the same thing is true for chloride also, and that's why we use word vice versa. Now, suppose you will say, sir, take chloride and tell me. Same thing happened for chloride ion also. One chloride ion is surrounded by six Na plus ion, right? Now, for example, suppose I am talking about, this is three-dimensional figure. So in that figure, purposely, we have shown with different color, this green color and this is blue color, right? Suppose I am talking about this one, okay? So here 1, then 2, then 3, and then 4. Similarly, one is on the upside and one is on the downside. So what I said in the sodium chloride crystal, one Na plus ion is surrounded by six Cl minus ion. And at the same time, one Cl minus ion is surrounded by six Na plus ion. I do understand it is a three-dimensional figure, difficult to visualize, but you have to make practice of it. I am pretty sure in 12th standard, you will have one chapter called solid state. And in that chapter, this kind of several diagram you will come across, right? So it is a three-dimensional structure of sodium chloride. And now let us see how to calculate formula mass. It is here. Okay, so formula mass, suppose for example, I want to calculate formula mass of Na plus plus Cl minus. Now you must be knowing sodium chloride, in sodium chloride, we have a sodium atom and we have a Cl atom. Now sodium atomic mass 23, then chlorine, actually chlorine exists in the form of two isotopes, Cl35, Cl37, the chlorine ka average atomic mass aata hai 35.5. So you can add this 23 for Na and 35.5 for chloride. So 23 plus 35.5, it sums up 58.5. The average, formula the mass of sodium chloride is 58.5. So go. So that is about the formula mass. Okay. And if you if you know how to calculate formula mass for sodium chloride, same formula you can apply for any other ionic compound like calcium chloride, magnesium sulfate. You know. So that is about the formula mass. Okay. Let us go ahead. Students. As you know well, that in the previous lecture, we discussed about the moles, terms mole, right? So now my next part is about the moles, okay? And we did this, we studied this in the last lecture. Still, it is, right time to revise the about mole once again. Now, just go through this mole. Okay. Now, mole is a term used to express large number of submicroscopic particles, that is atoms, ions, electrons. You know, they are very huge in number, and for such a large number of microscopic particles, your normal counting is not sufficient. So we should have something else to count, and that is why we use a term called mole. We discussed the meaning of mole last time. One mole is the amount of substance that contain as many entity or particle as they are present in exactly 12 gram of carbon 12 isotopes. That means you take literally 12 gram carbon 12 isotope and keep on counting the number of particles. And whatever number you will come across, that number is going to be one mole. That is going to be one mole, okay? So that is what we discussed. Now, please have a look. I told you to take 12 gram of sample of carbon 12 and keep on counting the number of particle present in that. And that whatever number we will come across, that is going to be one mole. But you know, the scientists have already worked out for the same thing for us. And today we can say ki one mole of any element or one mole of any substance is equal to this many particle, 6.022 1367 into 10 raised to 23 atom mole inverse. Okay, so this is what number of atom present in one mole. Now students, you can quote figure up to 3 digit, you can write down as a 6.022 into 10 raised to 23. So one mole of carbon 12 contain this many particle. How many particle? 6.022, right? 6.022 into 10 raised to 23, right? This many particle present. The particle can be atom, molecules, or ion. If it is element, it is atom. It is a compound, it can be molecule, right? So it can be atoms, molecules, or even ions also. Right, this is what the you can say the baseline. One mole is the amount of substance that contain this many particles, 6.022 into 10 raised to 23 particles. That means even if you in the sleep someone asks you ki one mole is equal to how much, so you should say it is 6.022 into 10 raised to 23 particles. And this number we are going to use while solving problem. Students, even if I say, ki suppose we have been given one mole of Na plus ion, so how many ion present in that? Obviously, the number remains same. One mole of Na plus ion equal to 6.022 into 10 raised to 23 Na plus ion. If I say, ki one mole of proton. So one mole of proton can be 6.022 into 10 raised to 23 protons, right? So one mole is equal to the 6.022 into 10 raised to 23 particles. I will correlate this with our real life. Whenever we say one dozen means collection of 12 items. That item can be pen, pencil, rubber, banana, mangoes, right? So likewise, here also, chemist gave us this number which is present in one mole. Okay, this is that. Very important number, you should remember it. And it is very useful to solve the problem. Now, let us talk about molar mass. Let us talk about molar mass. Now, you will say, ki, what is the difference between atomic mass and molar mass? Now, table is self-explanatory. Table is self-explanatory. Hydrogen ka atomic mass is one unified mass. Carbon ka atomic mass is a 12 unified mass. Oxygen ka atomic mass, 16 unified mass, right? But you look at the molar mass. Molar mass given in terms of gram, mole, inverse. The figure remains same, unit just change. 1 gram mole inverse, 12 gram mole inverse, 16 gram mole inverse, okay? So look at the meaning, mass of 1 mole of substance, that substance can be either element or it can be compound in gram. That is called as molar mass, right? In old textbook, it was expressed in terms of gram molar mass. Right, molar mass of any element in gram is numerically equal to atomic mass of that element. So this and this, it is same. Okay, only the unit has been changed. When it is time to express atomic mass, express in terms of unified mass, and when it is time to express molar mass, express in terms of gram mole inverse. So that is about the molar mass. Very simple concept. Mass of a 1 mole of a substance in gram is called as its molar mass. Students, it is right time to revise what we did so far. Okay, we did in the beginning atomic mass. We studied average atomic mass. Then we studied formula mass. Then we studied molar mass, right? Now, let us go to the next. Okay. Here in this table, I gave you molar mass of polyatomic substance. Polyatomic. Poly means what? Many. When any molecule contains more than 2 atoms, it's called as polyatomic substance. For example, in O2 molecule, there are 2 oxygen atoms. So it is a polyatomic substance. If I talk about H2O, in H2O, I have a 2 hydrogen atoms and 1 oxygen atom. So again, it is an example of polyatomic. Here, NaCl. In NaCl, we have 1 sodium atom and 1 chlorine atom. So it is an example of polyatomic substance. So molar mass of polyatomic substance can be also expressed here. Don't think that way we can express only monoatomic mass. We can express polyatomic substance molar mass also. For example, polyatomic mass substance like O2 having molar mass equal to 32 unified mass, 16 plus 16, that is 32. In H2O, we have 2 hydrogen, 1 oxygen. Hydrogen ka 2, oxygen ka 1. So 2 into 1, that is 2. 16 into 1, that is 16. So 2 plus 16, that is 18. So water ka molar mass is 18. Sodium chloride at molar mass is 58.5. 2 minutes back, I told you. Right, so Na ka 23, chlorine ka 35.5. Add together 23 plus 35.5, answer coming down to 58.5, right? Now, this is about the molar mass. But when it, this is about, you can say, mass expressed in terms of unified mass. But if I have to express molar mass, then quantity remains same, figures remain same, only unit changes. Unit is gram mole inverse, right? Gram mole inverse and gram mole inverse. See here? So say 30 oxygen, 32 unified mass, right? It is the molecular mass of oxygen. Molar mass is 32.0 gram mole inverse. Okay. So that is about the molar mass for polyatomic substances. Yes, polyatomic substances. Number of moles can be calculated, by measuring the volume. In fact, one can calculate by using mass also, but better to consider volume. Now, according to Avogadro's law, which we studied last time, one mole of any gas occupies volume equal to how much? 22.4 decimeter cube. That means if you take 1 mole of chlorine gas, the volume is 22.4 decimeter cube. If you take 1 mole of O2 gas, the volume remains same, 22.4 decimeter cube, right? If I take one mole of ammonia gas, then the volume remains same, 22.4 decimeter cube at STP. STP, I told you, standard condition of temperature and pressure. So volume which is occupied at STP by 1 mole of a gas, that is called as molar volume of a gas, right? Molar volume of a gas. In exam, perhaps question may come, what is molar volume of a gas? So you should be able to answer this question. Molar volume of a gas is the volume of 22.4 decimeter cube at STP. Okay, that is what the molar gas volume. Let us go to the next. In my previous lecture, we discussed these three formulas which are used to solve the problem. Suppose I want to calculate number of moles. So I can use this formula. Number of moles I have to calculate. So I can use this formula. Volume of a gas is HTP upon molar volume of a gas. Right. So a molar volume of gas is given to us, 22.4 decimeter cube. So only what to know? We should know volume of a gas at STP. If I know the volume of gas at STP, simplify the value here and get the number of moles. So very simple formula, right? So number of moles can be used, number of moles can be calculated by using this formula. Now, second important formula is this one, number of molecules. Number of molecules. Formula is given like this. Number of molecules is equal to number of moles into 6.022 into 10 to 23 molecules. Now suppose in the previous formula, I got number of moles. Substitute the value of number of moles here. Multiply by this Avogadro's number. And moment you multiply by this Avogadro's number, you automatically get number of molecules. Number of molecules. All right. So number of molecules can be calculated. Number of molecules can be calculated. Number of molecules can be calculated. If I know the number of moles, multiply by this number, right? This is a constant figure. That doesn't change. Only you should know the number of moles. Okay, go through the formulas. Very important formulas. And we are going to solve the problem based on these formulas. Now, here is the first formula comes. The problem is very simple. Always, and please remove the fear from your mind. Problem solving is very easy as compared to writing theory question, right? So practice makes man perfect. If you solve many more problems, you will be expert in solving problem. Look at the formula problem given here. Calculate the number of moles of hydrogen in 0.448 liter of hydrogen gas at STP. So you have been given volume of hydrogen, how much? 0.448, and you have been asked to calculate number of moles. Students, just now we saw the equation. Key 22.4 liter or 22.4 decimeter cube is the molar gas volume, and that volume corresponds to how much mole? 1 mole. So since 22.4 liter of hydrogen gas at SPP correspond to 1 mole, then for 0.448 liter of hydrogen gas at SPP correspond to how much? So do the cross multiplication. Do the cross multiplication. 0.448 into 1 upon 22.4. If you simplify this, the answer coming down to 0.02 mole. See, very simple it is, 0.02. A fourth standard numerical, you can say. Fifth standard, normally this kind of problem, primary students, they do in their class, right? So very simple problem that can give you 2 marks in examination if the problem comes. So this much volume is given of hydrogen and you have been asked to calculate number of moles. Students, in the exam, what can be changed? The name of the gas can be changed. Name of amount of gas can be changed, but the method of solving problem remains same. I repeat again, don't expect same problem in examination. Perhaps the same problem may come or may not be. And even if the teacher asks you a different problem, teacher can either change the name of the gas or can change the amount of gas. But the method of solving problem remains same, right? Next, we'll go to the next problem now. Yes. Students, I am referring to now that average atomic mass. In the today's lecture, I have explained you concept of average atomic mass and how to calculate I will discuss. Now here, for your understanding, let me tell you, boron exists in the form of two different isotopes. Boron, one is betaine, right? And the other one is B11. Ye do isotopes hai boron ke. Right? Now, betaine occur in nature up to 19.60% and boron 11 occur in the nature up to 80.40%. Exact isotopic mass of boron 10 is a 10.13 and 11.009, right? Respectively. The calculate average atomic mass of boron. In the today's lecture, I will discuss how to calculate average atomic mass. Because, you know, the trouble arises here, ki when there are two isotopes of boron, whether should we take atomic mass of boron as a 10 or should I take atomic mass of boron as a 11? That is the question in front of us. So don't take 10, don't take 11 also, take average of both. And how to calculate? Look here, average atomic mass of boron, B for boron, given by formula 10.13 is the actual atomic mass of boron into 19.60, that is percentage occurrence of boron 10, right, upon 100 plus second isotope, boron 11, uska actual atomic mass is how much? 11.009. So 11.009 into 18.40, that is the percentage occurrence upon 100. So simplify this fraction. So iska answer comes 1.98, iska answer comes 8.85, add them together, answer coming down to 10.83. So if someone asks me, sir, what is the average atomic mass of boron? So answer is 10.83. So go through the problem solving, right? Go through the problem solving for one minute. Now, next. Yes. If you are comfortable with the second problem, let us move to the third problem. Yes, let us move to the third problem. Calculate the number of moles and molecules of acetic acid present in 22 gram of acetic acid. Now, always read the problem carefully. See what is given to you. Write the things in the form of data and decide the proper formula and then do the calculation. Students, molecular formula of acetic acid. It is not given to us. We should know the formula of acetic acid, because after knowing formula of acetic acid only, we will be able to calculate molecular weight. Now, please have a look. Acetic acid formula is CH3COOH. Acetic acid formula is CH3COOH. Now, in acetic acid, there are two carbon atoms. So 2 into 12, right? There are four hydrogen atoms. 4 into 1, right? So this is, right. Then 4 into 1. Then there are two oxygen atoms. So 2 into 16, right? Now here, 12 into 2, that becomes 24. 4 into 1, that becomes 4. That is 24 plus 4, 28. And this is that 16 plus 2, that is 32. And 32 plus 28, that sums up 60. So molecular weight of acetic acid is given 60 gram mole inverse, right? So this is what the molecular mass of acetic acid, though it was not given, we have calculated. Now, my next step is what? 60 gram of acetic acid corresponds to 1 mole. So how much is given in our problem? In problem, acetic acid given 22 gram. So for 22 gram is how much? So do the cross multiplication. 22 into 1 upon 60. Upon 60, you know? 22 into 1 upon 60. The simplification is how much? 0.3667. This is the mole of acetic acid. Now, 60 gram of acetic acid correspond to this many molecules. So for 22 gram of acetic acid, how much molecule? So do the cross multiplication. 22 gram into 6.022 into 10 to 23 upon 60. So on simplification, this fraction, we are getting answer equal to 2.2081 into 10 raised to 23 molecules. That means in a 22 gram of sample of acetic acid, we obtain this many molecules. Look at the job, look at the work done by the scientist, right? Avogadro. Even you have been given a sample of liquid or sample of gas, we are in position to calculate number of molecules present, which is literally difficult, right? So this is the great job done by the scientists. Next. Okay. Now, take one more example. 24 gram of carbon react with some oxygen to make 88 gram of carbon dioxide. Find out how much oxygen must have been used. Read the problem very carefully and then you can skip on solving. Now you know well, carbon on reaction with oxygen gives us CO2. Carbon plus O2 gives you CO2. So carbon is 1 mole, that is 12 gram. O2 again 1 mole, that is 32 gram. So when they combine together, we get CO2 1 mole, that is 44 gram. So 12 gram of carbon correspond to 32 gram of oxygen. So now 24 gram of carbon correspond to how much? Once again, do the cross multiplication here. 24 into 32 upon 12 on simplification. Answer, you are getting this much answer. Look here, the answer is 64 gram of oxygen. Again, very simple problem, can give you 2 marks. Okay, so that, go through the problem for 1 minute and then, okay. Very simple problem it is, right? So please remove the fear from your mind. Problem solving is very easy. Okay, so now this is the right time to conclude here. I am stopping my sharing of the screen. Okay, so let us see what we discuss. Okay, so there, anyhow, we have concluded the lecture at this stage. Remaining part we'll see in my next class. Thank you.
Thank you, sir.